we're going to do here is we're going to do, Gus is going to come up here and he's going to do a demo on the gas additive and compare against some of the competitors' products. And then he's going to go into talking a little bit about fuel and what's going on with fuel, with ethanol and different things, and why we need an additive. And then after he's finished with that, I'll come up and I'll do a demo with the gas additive, or with the diesel additive, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about the diesel side of it and what's going on there. So we'll just go ahead and get started, and I'm going to bring Gus up.
Yeah.
Well, welcome everybody. I'm going to shift this over a little bit where that camera is. So, quick question. How many of you have ever used an additive in any kind of vehicle or any kind of a... Few people, okay. Well, to start out with, what we're going to do is we're going to bring up some of the challengers, as we say. So, your choice of any of these over here, which one do you want to see?
Any of them. Any of them.
Any of them, yeah.
Okay. Which is the best one?
Xp3.
Best one besides Xp3.
STP is still one of the top sellers in the country.
Is it?
Yeah, Startron is one of the new...
All the gas stations.
And so we'll go with that, and then we'll go with the one that, of course, almost everybody has either used or at least heard of, Seafoam. Okay. And then we're already up here. Okay. All right. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna do a little burn test with all these, just to see how they burn. Most of these, if not all of them, claim to be able to do something with cleaning your fuel system. So we want to see what that kind of looks like. We're just going to go up a little bit of each of these. And this one's not even open yet. Can somebody give me a reason why you would use a fuel treatment?
Help with the water.
Help with water, okay.
Well, better gas mileage.
Better gas mileage, that's a little much.
Treat it over winter.
Okay.
Storage,
yep. How about when your car doesn't seem to be running as good as it could?
Injector cleaners and stuff like that.
Cleaning out the injectors. Trying to get a little more power out of your vehicles. There's lots of reasons that people use these additives. And the nice thing, which I'll get into a little bit later, is most of the problems can be solved with one of these. And lastly, our Xp3. Okay. We've got wood Q-tips up here and regular ones. I like the regular ones just because they don't tend to burn off like the wood ones do. You can see a little bit better on some of these. Not have to worry about the wood actually burning. So, this is our Briggs & Stratton. Can you see any of that? You think that's helping your engine clean? Or your fuel system clean? Okay, now we're going to STP. Let's see what this guy does. I think we're just about as bad.
Yeah.
Okay, now for Startron, the new up and comer. Lots of people have heard and use this one.
Yeah.
I think about the same. And now for the favorite of many people, the Seafoam. A little better. And now, lastly, our XP3. I can let that burn and burn. And you're not going to see any smoke coming off of it. Can anybody of the new people tell me what smoke is coming off of a flame when you're dealing with fuel?
Unburned fuel.
Unburned fuel. So that's blowing your gas mileage. Now, one of the problems that was mentioned with these is water. A lot of these claim to do something with water. Just look at this one and see if it doesn't say anything right up the top of it. This one clearly states right on here, controls moisture in fuels. That one basically did the stabilizer. That's tip all over. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to put five drops in each of these.
And will our come from Flint?
He's very proud of his Irish background.
Yeah, he's getting independent.
Right there.
This is just a little food coloring in here so you can see it when it gets into the. Come on in, we got a front row spot for you.
Hey. I'm all about front row spots.
Come on up, Brian. I only don't want to bring in.
We got chemistry going on.
Yeah, we got chemistry going on.
All right, that's. If we were playing tic tac toe, we would have just won.
You
three Brians.
You've heard.
You tell me.
That we have occasionally have water problems with our fuel.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we're going through. We've already burned them. We'll go back and burn them again. Fun part. But we're just going through what each of these products do when you put water into them. Okay. Can you see the green hue on the bottom of that, all that red? Oh, let's bring them up. So, where's the water on these first four?
On the bottom.
Sitting on the bottom. And can you see the water is totally blended into our XP3. Okay, so now we can go back and burn them again.
Again, that's the Irish, huh? It's a burn.
We burn them, okay.
That's what we call a redneck sparkler.
It's even red, too.
Yeah.
But I'm seeing that red.
And if you notice, the smoke tends to get a little bit blacker.
Start trying to see too much.
And lastly, the one that claims that can actually controls moisture in fuel or in your. Isn't that fun? Ooh, that's neat. And then lastly, our XP3. Now, sometimes it's tough to see the flame, but eventually it does come up, but there's still absolutely no crackle, no smoke, totally clean burning flame. So, when it comes to cleaning out your injector system or your fuel system or even cleaning out the top end of your engine, which of these do you think might stand a chance doing it? The one that has a clean burning flame. And we clearly point out that it takes care of water. I mean, it literally, you saw no evidence of the water when we burned it, right? Okay, so that's some for our demo part of it. Pardon?
On the gas side.
Yeah. On the gas side, yes. So, how does water get into our fuels? Anybody have any ideas?
Out of the air, and alcohol and the ethanol just love it.
Out of the air, alcohol and ethanol just love it, exactly. Alcohol and ethanol are actually sponges. They love to suck water. The condensation in the tanks when they put the fuel into the ground happens just because of a change in temperature. You put it in your vehicle changes temperature on a daily basis. You put it in the gas can, your gas can changes temperature and causes condensation, which then gets into the fuel and can cause the different problem you have. When it comes to small engines, the water is even worse of an issue there, because most small engine, the gas tank, the fuel comes out of the bottom of the tank. So water's at the bottom of the tank, so the first thing to go into the engine is the water. That's a lot of times why the units are so hard to start, until you can get rid of that water through the carburetor before it finally gets the gas and will finally start. The next problem with gasoline is the life of the gasoline itself. Anybody care to guess what the typical life of gasoline with ethanol before it starts to decline in its ability to power your vehicle well?
30 days.
30 days?
That's what I was going to say.
30,
90, 90 days.
How many?
90.
90?
60.
Actually, it's 21 days. 21 days from leaving the refinery. That's not 21 days from when you put it in your tank. So sometimes it takes a week to get from the refinery to the gas station. So now you put fuel in a tank, and say you have a car that doesn't get used very often, you can have fuel that's bad and causing problems in your engine within a matter of a week or two. There are products out there, say Stable. Stable, most people use that when they're storing their vehicle. They're not using it as in an everyday situation because you don't really want to be burning that stuff that much in your vehicles, whereas Xp3 actually will stabilize your fuel indefinitely. And we say indefinitely with a caveat that it does have to be agitated. We recommend once every 6 months. So if you have a 5 gallon can of gas that you take and have for your small engines around the yard, if you're putting fuel into something every week or every 2 weeks, you don't have to worry about that. If you have a snowmobile that you're putting away for the summer, typically it's about 6 months before you're pulling it back up. You don't have to worry about that. It's just once things are going over 6 months time that you want to just agitate it. And the reason for needing the agitation is because when fuel ages, it will do what we call phasing. What happens when it phases is, especially with the alcohol or the ethanol, it separates from the gasoline. And if you don't have a product in there that's dealing with the water, it'll actually separate the water out and the gasoline and the ethanol. Now, there's a little minor problem with that is ethanol has a higher octane rate than gasoline. And so when the ethanol separates out of the gasoline will start to drop in octane. So now you're causing another problem because you're not burning at the rate once you get through. Either you're burning the ethanol, which is burning too hot, or you're burning the gasoline, which is burning too low. And either one of those is going to cause problems. The ethanol also causes corrosion very readily. It actually will deteriorate anything rubber. So any seals, any gaskets that are rubber, the ethanol will cause to have problems and need to be replaced. Our Xp3 product in there eliminates all those ethanol issues and keeps everything lubricated. It lubricates the whole engine and in the top end of the engine, and any seals or anything that it comes in contact with, it's going to keep them from having any issues with the ethanol. One of the other problems in fuel is contaminants that get into the fuel, and the Xp3 will actually help take care of those contaminants and eliminate them, so they're not causing a problem when they're going through your engines. Anybody ever understood that when they put ethanol into gasoline, you get less mileage?
Oh, yeah.
Because ethanol is a doesn't have the energy equivalent of gasoline. So anytime you add the ethanol into it, you're just decreasing your mileage. One of these side effects, I call it, benefits, other people call it, with Xp3 is the potential of doing away with that decrease in mileage and getting an increase in mileage. Now we don't want to say yes, you're going to get a good big bump in your mileage, because you never know what's going on with your vehicle. You could have a computer issue that's not going to let your vehicle get better mileage. You're going to have something else in with your fuel system that might cause it to not get increased mileage. But generally, most people do see an increase in their mileage because of the energy uptick in the fuel. One of the other things that the Xp3 does in the fuel is it causes the fuel to atomize better than your normal fuel, so you have smaller particles which then burn at a better rate, so you get a cleaner burn, and that's one of the things we say we reduce emissions by 60%. That's why we reduce the emissions, is because the atomization of the fuel going into the engine and being able to burn at a better rate. The last thing we're going to talk about was corrosion, which we went over a little bit, but the corrosion will actually cause more friction in your engine, cause increased wear of your engine. The Xp3 will, again, as I said, lubricate the top end of your engine, and it's shown to reduce the friction to the point that 80% of the heavy metals that normally come out of the engine and go into the oil are not going into the oil because of the reduction in the friction on the top end of the engine. One of the things that's kind of interesting, if you look at the different fuel additives that are out there, there's a company that actually has gone through and tested different, I don't remember how many of the additives they've actually tested, but they've gone through and tested them to find out how many of them contain alcohol. And how many of them are actually able to deal with water in the fuel. And going down the list, it's probably 90% of the additives that they tested showed to have alcohol in them. So now you're using alcohol to try to treat an alcohol-related problem. And that, to me, doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. And again, going through there, a majority of them say they deal with water. Well, We had four out of the ones here that show how they deal with water. They deal with water by putting water to the bottom of the fuel tank. Another reason for using Xp3 is we have 10% ethanol in our tanks or in our fuel right now, but that 10% may or may not be 10%. It's kind of regulated, but they've already, by law, passed that you can have 15% ethanol in gasoline, so some companies are getting up to 15%, even though they say 10%. And the truck drivers, when they go in to pick up their tank of fuel, the truck drivers are paid by their tank of fuel and getting it to you. So if they have longer line for one fuel versus another fuel, they'll find the short line and fill up with a fuel that might not be what they're supposed to be getting, but what they say that they're getting, and then deliver that to the gas station. So if there's a possibility of a 15% ethanol fuel, but they say they're delivering 10, but the 15% is shorter, you may end up with 15% at your gas station. Now, one of the interesting things is the manufacturer's warranties stipulate no more than 10% ethanol in your fuel. Well, how are you supposed to guarantee you're not putting more than 10% ethanol into your vehicle when you, the only way to really know how much ethanol is in your fuel is by going and testing it. And nobody's going to want to sit and test every tank of fuel that they put in. Anything that I've missed, Mike?
No.
Okay, any questions?
Does it raise the octane of the gas?
It does not raise the octane of the gas, but it makes it burn better because of the atomization of it.
What's in the product? What's it made of?
We cannot tell you what's in the product because we don't know what's in the product, because that is a trade secret by the manufacturer of the product. He won't. There are certain things we can tell you because they're on the MSDS sheet, but most it's organic and it's synthetic. It is not hazardous waste if it gets spilled on the ground. But other than that, they won't allow us to know what's actually in it because he doesn't want anybody to be able to try to copy it.
It's bioorganic compounds and resins. So if it hits the ground, it literally becomes fertilizer. You can put it on your tongue. It'll disperse the water in your tongue. I've done it. And you feel like you've got no decay. But it's organic. It's not going to hurt you. If you were to consume enough of it, you'd probably spend the entire afternoon and maybe a day or two in the bathroom and clean you out. But not going to kill you. That's very different than if you look at these products or you look at, you know, even other multiple marketing products that are out there. It's literally an organic compound.
So how long will it last? I mean, if you get 5 gallons of it or a quarter, whatever, how long is that shelf life?
It has no shelf life, meaning there is no expiration.
It's indefinite.
It is.
Yep. Our U.S. government has used it for a lot of years. They actually help us with the technology behind it.
So what are they putting it in? The military stuff?
I remember they had problems with bulk tanks. They've got storages all over the world. Maybe sitting in the same problem that you would as a farmer sitting there with it sitting too long. You're going to develop water in a bulk tank just like you would in a, you have a 7-degree temperature difference between gas and air, you're going to suck water in. It's just, that's all it takes.
Any other questions?
Did you have fun? Having
a t-shirt on with this wasn't probably the best idea either. So, well, that's my part of it. So now I'm going to bring up Mike Mickelson to go through the diesel part of it. So let's welcome up Mike.
All right. Well, one little thing I'd like to just add to that is that, you know, with all the talk about the ethanol, a lot of guys and a lot of their answer to the problem is that they're going to buy premium fuel. That's great. You're not dealing with the ethanol. But you're still going to get water through condensation, relative humidity, and things like that. You can't get away from that water issue that's going to happen in fuel. And our newer vehicles, the way they're designed today, are designed to accommodate for the alcohol in fuel. The alcohol actually helps clean. And everybody knows that our fuels today weren't like they were 20 years ago. I don't care if it's a premium or not. So you're still dealing with issues. You're still going to have an additive in there. So I'd like to clear that up on that. I was a premium user because I wasn't finding the answers either. And I will tell you today, I use nothing but 87 octane. And I'm outperforming anything I ever did in premium. So,
I'm sorry. I was going to ask you, because you're running small engines all the time.
Yep.
So, on the gas side, have you noticed a difference in just chainsaws and in performance, or not so much there?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I've been using the product for 2 years, and I haven't had a fuel-related problem in anything. Now, chainsaws, well, I have a tree business, just to clear that up for you.
Okay, so
I have a tree business. So that means I've got a lot of chainsaws, and I'm using them on a commercial basis. Mm-hmm. A commercial chainsaw has a lot of issues with it, and we have a lot of carburetor issues. If you're using the premium, what we're seeing is they're getting some sort of a glassy green substance inside the carburetor that gets so hard that they can't drill through it with a drill, so they throw your carburetor away.
Is that the premium or the non-oxy or both?
Well, both. I'm getting both. Mixed on that, but here's my theory on it. I can't prove it. I can't back it up, no matter how many questions I've asked. But I believe that it is the detergents that they're putting in our premium fuel. Hence the green hue. But whatever. I mean, there's an issue there where the guys that are using the ethanol-based products don't seem to be having as many problems. But yeah, it's huge for me. I haven't had any carburetor rebuilds, carburetor replacements, none of that stuff on any of my saws. And that's, downtime for me is, you know, that's money. I'm losing money. And then replacement of equipment. Now, you know, I've got more cost in my business. If I can push that piece of equipment further and make it last longer, then I make more money without cutting into my overhead. So,
babe. You're getting more hours than out of each one of those saws, then? Is that kind of?
Yeah, I am. I am definitely getting more hours out of those saws. They seem to start better. They seem to run better when you're up at that full rev. When you're, I mean, I'm commercial, man. I got that trigger ripped. I'm not feathering that, you know. I'm seeing a lot better performance. It's great. I love it when I'm around other people with chainsaws, or, you know, I use contract climbers and stuff, and these guys will come out and they're happy to get my fuel and put in there because their saws start running better as soon as they put my fuel in it. Mm. It's great to see other guys fighting with that stuff, and I'm thinking, man, 2 years ago that was me. You know, you literally get frustrated with a saw and throw it and go grab another one. You know, and I don't have that problem. If I got a saw going in the shop, it's my fault. I did it. I dropped a tree on it.
We probably did that one time.
Yeah, sometimes other people do.
You got white fingers at all on that one?
Yeah, well, I'm just bored myself. Yeah. Yeah.
That's all right.
You
all did it.
I've done it.
Yeah. You know, and that's it. I mean, there's always going to be a certain amount of maintenance to our vehicles. And I searched. I did the premium fuel. I searched for answers. We're going to be talking about the diesel and stuff, too. I searched for those. You know, I plow snow in the wintertime. You know, there is nothing worse than your skid steer gelling up in the middle of a commercial parking lot at 2 a.m. And it can't be there because by 6 a.m. that place is filling up. That is not any fun. I've been there, done it a couple of times. I haven't had any of those kind of problems. I haven't had injector problems. I haven't had any of that. So for me, this was big. And I was looking and searching for answers with all the fuel problems I had. And then it's actually Gus that came to me at a home show I was doing for my tree service. And he knew that I was having fuel problems and issues. He came up and he told me some of the benefits of this product, and I grilled him and I quizzed him, and I said, all right, well, I'm open-minded, I'm gonna try it, but I'm expecting the same results that everything else has given me. Maybe you get a little bit of a benefit, but not enough to justify the purchase of the product. So, again, I can't emphasize, I've been very happy. It's really cut down
on those breakdowns and those problems in the last 2 years. So I'm going to do the demo here. I'm going to do, and it's kind of funny, you know, I got all these products here to talk about. These are products that I had around my house because they're the ones I've tried. So now I just get to burn them a little bit when I need to do a demo here. So you said you were farming, right? Did you ever use Howes?
No.
I got a lot of farmers around here that use Howes.
Okay.
STP diesel treatment, that's another one that I've run into a few guys that are doing that, and it was actually recommended to me at one point in time when I was having my issues. Gel ups and things like that, wintertime use, you know, guys are recommending 911 and this other power service product here, so we'll demo both of them.
I don't drive a diesel anything.
Yeah.
But are we still having the same problems with gel ups like they did back in, you know, I grew up in agricultural America, so it was always a problem for farmers.
Well,
you know, back in the 70s. Is that still, I don't hear as big an issue as...
Actually, I'm hearing exactly the opposite. I'm hearing more, but here's okay. The interesting thing. And here I got just some regular number 2 diesel I'm going to put in and burn too. What I'm hearing is that we're having more problems with the gel up, and what you'll find out when I talk here is I don't believe that we're gelling up, because one of the things with gel up was it was paraffins, it was wax, and the wax was in the diesel fuel. But when we went down to 15 parts per million in ultra low sulfur, we took a lot of the paraffins out of the product. But the problem was, now we've created an issue where our diesel fuel can't deal with the water, so we got a lot more free water. And so I believe that our gel ups aren't actually gel ups, I believe that they're freeze ups. So, I'm going to use the wood Q-tips, just like, I don't want to stick my finger down in that nasty stinking chemical, so. So we're going to do, oh wait a minute, I don't have XP3 in there.
Well, I've already seen XP3, so.
All right, well, you've seen XP3, but I would like to, I'd still like to do it anyway, just for.
Yeah, is there a difference between the two products, the green and the red?
Yeah, yes, yeah, the diesel.
Yep, oh,
yeah, yeah, but, okay.
The red is the diesel, yep.
So there's different chemicals that they've put into that.
Well, here's the thing, you know, diesel fires under compression. So. It's not as highly flammable. If you've ever poured gasoline on a bonfire or diesel on a bonfire, you know, you get two completely different responses, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. One's real bad.
One goes boom.
So
you lose your eyebrows.
So gasoline has to be ignited. The explosion drives, but in the diesel, it's under compression to ignite. That's why you don't have spark plugs. So, all right, let's do that real quick. So let's burn all these other products here. So we got the Howes here. And a very smoky, dirty product. This is STP. I don't even want to blow that stuff out next to my face. This stuff's nasty, you know, especially getting in the power service. You get a shot of that up the nose. Okay, so here's your STP diesel treatment. Look at that.
Looks like some of the candles in my house.
I guarantee you they don't smell as good. So here's one of our power service products. I mean, look at that. Look at it shoot down the... Here's one of the other power service. And look at how filthy that is. And those two products, those are the two most popular products. And look at the soot buildup just on that, just for lightning for that little bit. And then we got straight diesel. I mean, everybody's been behind a diesel truck, they know what it does. So and then again, XP3. So it's a very clean burning product. then again, we're going to do it because some of these products are clear. I put that one drop of green food coloring in here. I've done the test both ways. It doesn't affect the test at all. I can do it with regular water. It's the same thing. So we'll do the same thing Gus did. We'll just add about 5 drops of water. I'm sure we'll get enough differentiation doing that. That was like 3.
So no, we're not coming at all.
Yeah.
Oh, the lightning person.
Well, we'll make it a little fair just in case. I'll put a couple more in there. So, as you can see, every single one of those products, you can see that green at the bottom. You know, and, you know, I mean, it's simple science. Oil and water can't mix. There is no way to make that mix. So, those claims saying that we can deal with water, they can't. You know, maybe they can deal something with emulsified water. Maybe their product will stabilize emulsified water, but they can't do anything with free water. And that's what's happening in our engines now. So, and then again here, you can see there's sort of a green hue that's consistent through the whole product. So again, we'll just burn it. We already know how this is going to go, but just for fun, and I like lighting stuff on fire, let's do it again.
Like fireworks.
You know, I like scaring Brian up here in front of all.
Which one?
Yeah, three of us, yeah.
So you see there's a little crackle there. It's still really dirty. That was the hollow. STP, that's a nice sparkler. I'll have to remember that. Power service. And you're still getting that crackle and stuff in there. You know, a lot of these products, a lot of these like power service and things like that, they tell you to use these at the gel up point. You take your filter off, you take your water separator filter off, you pour that product in, and you start. And what it is it ignites easier than regular diesel fuel. It's almost like a cetane booster. And what it does is it gets that heat circulating in that system to get that fuel moving again. That's really all that product does. Little crackle there. I mean, and even dirtier, I think. So there's what water does in your diesel. That's misfire. So, very clean. Very good burning product. So that's it on that part of it, and then we'll just talk a little bit about the diesel and get into some of those things like you were asking about. So, you know, number one thing is that we get water in the diesel. We get water in the diesel through condensation and, again, relative humidity. Fuel is going to equalize with whatever the humidity is outside. That's just natural. That's going to happen. This is why a boat on the water has a tendency to have more water in the fuel, is because the humidity on the lake is going to be higher. You know, I mean, we've literally had pontoon boats. I've talked to marinas with a 25-gallon tank, and they've pulled 5 gallons of water out of the thing. It's a problem. The other thing is, we got our biodiesel blends. A lot of people don't know, but we are mixing biodiesel with a regular diesel. And there's kind of like the ethanol, there's like a 10% biodiesel blend in diesel. Now, biodiesel, by nature, holds about 20% water. It's actually made by spraying high-pressure water through it. So it's got a certain amount of water in it. Hence, the more problems that we're having with water with those freeze-ups I was telling you about. Another big problem with the diesel is the soot. Obviously, you can see all of those products, how dirty they burned and everything like that. And that soot that's being created is, it dirties the injectors. It's the nasty exhaust. It's part of the reason why we have the new systems on all of these new trucks and stuff like that, the regen systems for burning the particulate matter and changing what's coming out of the tailpipe. Now they're very effective at what they got out of the tailpipe. We're getting nitrogen and we're getting water out of the tailpipe of a diesel. Now, we created a lot of problems in the meantime. But the government and EPA was only concerned with what we were doing to the air. So we've got truck drivers, semi drivers and stuff like that. You know, their stacks, they're blowing that black smoke out the back, and their white trailers are getting filthy. You guys are cleaning them, washing them at least once a month. And the guys that are using our product are noticing that there's a dramatic decrease in those issues. They are having to clean those trailers a lot less because of that up to 60% reduction in emissions. The other thing we've got is we've got California is one of the strictest states in the country on their emissions. And truck drivers are literally putting this product in the truck before they enter, and they're passing those emission standards without having to do expensive upgrades to their vehicles. We are just a lot more effective burning product. You know, we stabilize the fuel and keep it right where it's supposed to be at for its optimal performance. Okay. Let's get into the low sulfur thing. This I could talk a little while for, but I'll keep it short. You know, your farm, what's the majority age of your equipment on the farm?
Most of it's new.
You got a lot of new stuff?
Yeah, I got
it. Okay. So, but a lot of farmers around here, my dad included and stuff was a farmer, a lot of these farmers are running with equipment that was before 1993. Prior to 1993, we had high sulfur diesel, 5,000 parts per million. And then between 93 and 2006, we tried to clean up our emissions again, so we went to low sulfur diesel, which was 500 parts per million. Now we're at 15. What does that mean? That means that we don't have the hydrocarbons in the fuel that we need to create the thermal energy that diesel fuel requires to run effectively and efficiently. It's why gas mileage has gone down on diesels. The other thing is when we cut all that sulfur out of there, we cut out all of the lubricity. It's why these engines are running drier. We're seeing in oil analysis and things like that, we're seeing a lot more metal frag in the oil when these tests are being done. But seeing a dramatic change when they start using our product. Brian was talking about this busing company earlier out in Seattle, and they did a $5,000 test and a $6,000 test. And they're very impressed with the product after using it, and now recommending it to all the busing outfits and the school districts in the whole state. So it's a big deal. I mean, we got big trucking outfits, big commercial outfits that use this product. And those are some of the big reasons. You know, that our fuels, again, like I told you earlier, our fuels have changed quite a bit, and even in the last few years. And these older pieces of equipment, even like my 2005 Duramax was designed to run on 5,000 parts per million. So running this newer stuff, you're tearing that truck up, because it doesn't have the lubricity. And they've tried to counteract that a little bit, and they've added detergents and surfactants and stuff like that in there. But now the problem is when you added the surfactants, and if you don't know what surfactants are, they're basically your foaming agents, they're your soap. And anybody that's tried to fill up a 5-gallon jug at the pump knows when you get about 2/3 of the way full, the foam's gonna trip the trigger on the thing, because there's so much soap in it. Those surfactants coat water separating media, so we are again non-effectively dealing with water in diesel. You know, as long as we're kind of talking about that with the low sulfur and everything, let's talk about the regen systems. I don't know if you know what these regen systems are on these newer trucks and stuff, but so even a pickup truck, I've got a customer of mine here, actually Scandia Heating, is running Xp3 in his new 2015 Dodge 3/4 ton with the diesel in it. Okay, In the exhaust system, there's essentially two catalytic converters. There's one here, there's one here. And then in the middle is where they spray the DEF fluid. And that DEF fluid is the stuff that recognizes the particulate matter coming out of the first catalytic converter, and it sprays that, and it changes the composure of that particulate matter. So by the time it comes out the tailpipe, that's how we're ending up with nitrogen and water instead of the pollution that we were getting before. Problem with those systems is you're adding DEF, and they're extremely expensive to fix. That system of exhaust right now, if you were to replace that on that truck, and they're only the manufacturers are saying roughly about 100,000 miles you're going to have to replace it, it's a $7,000 change. Now they do have some shops are doing something like they got like almost like a parts washer where they can take that section of exhaust out and they can blow air through it and they can get the ash out of it so they can literally clean it and then put it back in, and that's going to save you maybe the first time, but by the time you get to the next time you're probably looking at a replacement. So what we're seeing when you add our fuel additive is those regen systems are running a whole lot less. Now I told you about JR and Scandia here with Scandia Heating. I just checked with that truck, and usually what happens, you fill your DEF fluid when you have your oil change, and the oil change is recommended for 10,000 miles. So he had his first 10,000 miles, and then he had his DEF topped off. Now he's over 3,000 miles into his next tank, and he's only used about an eighth of that DEF. It's a smart system, so when it recognizes the particulate matter, it sprays. It doesn't just spray all the time. So we've cut down on the particulate matter that's going through his exhaust, so he's cutting down on his DEF usage substantially. And it's not that expensive, but it does have a testimony to that our product is working. The other thing too, in talking about particulate matter, there's particulate matter that's right in our diesel fuel when we get it. Water creates the rust. We can get dirt in there because the refining process isn't extensive like it is with gasoline. And then the other big thing is, remember I told you that we're adding 10% biodiesel, and we have algae and stuff growing in that stuff? Well, they're trying to deal with algae in these tanks by adding biocide. Biocide will kill the algae, but what that does is create a sediment that falls to the bottom of the tank. So now you've got all this sediment in there. And I don't know, you guys that are dealing with diesel, if you've ever seen where your filter, like if you know, I've got one piece of my equipment, my chipper actually, has these glass filters on it. And at the bottom of the filter, there's this reddish to blackish sludge that's at the bottom of that. And that was when I bought the chipper, I noticed that. And of course, now since I've been using Xp3, and it doesn't happen. But that's what that is. That's all that, it's all that particulate matter that's right in the fuel itself. Now, another thing is, why is that a big deal? Is with this increase in our emissions, we've changed the diesels quite a bit, where our injectors are 2 microns now, and we're running a 30,000 PSI system. So to give you an idea of what 2 microns is, your average hair is 100 microns. So we're spraying fuel through something that small. That particulate matter plays a big role in getting into there and following out your injectors and stuff. And we are seeing more and more people having injector problems since we've gone to adding the biodiesel and going to ultra low sulfur. So it's created a big, big, big problem. And it's left in our pocketbooks to deal with it. And this is the cheapest, easiest way to deal with it. I haven't had any injector issues. I haven't had any gel ups. I don't have that same sediment going on in my filters. You know, I'm very happy with it.
that's pretty much good enough. I think we can go with that. Who's got questions on that diesel? What do you got?
Okay. When you suspend the water, you run it through the injector, what keeps the water from blowing up the nozzle of the injector?
It keeps it emulsified.
I know, that's a bad thing.
Well, there's emulsified water already in the fuel, and you want it to stay that way because at that point in time, it's small enough to go through those injectors. What happens where we run into the problem with the water in the diesels when we get free water is when it actually gets to a point where it can no longer hold water, it drips out. And then your pickups on those fuel pumps and fuel tanks are at the bottom, so you're picking up water right up. That's the water you don't want.
I've lost injectors because of that. I mean, it blows up. I mean, we end up putting extra filters on all our trucks and separate the water outside, water separation. It basically stopped me from having my injectors. But because when the water goes in through the fuel system and water, you know, when you try to burn water, it turns to steam. When you take water and take the steam, there's this great deal of pressure, more so than fuel, and yep. It'll actually damage the injector.
Yeah, our product actually breaks that water up into the hydrogen and oxygen, is what our product does. So it doesn't remain a water when it does that. But again, like I said, that emulsified water is different than free water. Because you've got emulsified water that's going to go through that injector system and stuff. And that emulsified water isn't the water that's collected in your water separators. It's the free water that's coming out. Because as they start to come out, as they start to fall out, they group together. And that's when you got a problem. That's when it can't go through your injector. That's when you get your steam issues and things like that.
Yeah, if you look at the green dyes, we bring it back over, you'll notice still there's no water in ours because literally that water molecule is so stretched, it's hydrogen oxygen. There's still, like if you were to run a water fine paste, there's no water.
I got water fine paste.
But when he burnt that, I did see it be a little spark, like a water spark.
Burn it again, there's no water.
Yeah, it's not a water spark. The diesel additive itself is a little bit different than the gas.
Okay, it's a little different than it was.
Yeah, and part of that might be the wood Q-tip too. I'm not 100% sure.
If you treat this with a 1x rate of XP, with gelling, what does that? How far does that take you down?
And we have all of our diesel stuff will drop the pour point.
To what?
Well, here's the interesting thing. Our extreme winter blend will drop the pour point of whatever the fuel is 35 degrees.
Okay.
If you have a minus 20, we'll drop it to minus 35.
Our standard will drop it
minus 55.
Our standard will drop at 15, whatever the gel weight is.
15
degrees.
50, okay, that's
the stuff. That's a standard. That's in all of our XP3 is standard. We don't charge for that. We don't have, like if you use, I think you mentioned he, and I'm very familiar with Syntec. They tried to recruit me and flew me out and all that stuff. They have an anti-gel that is 15 degrees.
Yeah, 2x rates 30.
Yeah.
Okay.
But our extreme will drop standard fuel to 35 below, it'll take a winter blend to 55 below and by Minnesota standards.
Okay.
So by Indiana standards, it's gonna take you to 40 below and 55 below. I checked your fuel because you mentioned you were coming.
Yeah, fuel, well it depends on, a guy I buy my fuel from actually, believe it or not, you got different pipelines coming into the Indianapolis area and they all have to give a report.
Yep.
Okay,
yep.
And so, so he makes sure that we try to start out with a pour point of zero, around zero. There's a lot of them that comes in at 7, 10 above.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah.
So then when you treat it,
15 degrees, And it'll take your zero to
minus 15. Yeah. So normally that takes care of most of Indiana weather.
Right.
Not all. Not all Indiana weather. So most. And it, like I said, the extreme winter will drop it another 35 degrees. So if you're rated for that zero,
yeah,
you're going to be good for minus 35. And then the pour rate on the XP3 extreme winter itself is minus 67 degrees.
Okay. But what now? That's all you sell is the extreme, or you have to.
No. No, this is the regular. This is going to drop you the 15 that he was talking about.
Okay.
So you would probably be able to get away with that.
Don't we have a diesel and then a winter diesel and then extreme diesel?
We do. We do put out, you know, in the fall, we starting like in September, I think, or something, we start putting out. And that does, it just, the blower changes when you buy it, but there's no extra charge to it. Now, the extreme winter blend, it does go up in price because there's a lot more work in the formulation in that.
Has your product, so work have to be above 32 degrees?
No.
Okay, so it can actually be gelled if you pour it in and ungel it?
No.
Yeah?
No problem.
No, nothing nothing I have ever seen, nothing I've ever found will ever ungel.
But heat, but warm.
Heat will.
Heat does.
But if it's not gelled, This is a
preventative. As long as this is in there ahead of time and you're using it on a consistent basis, doing it every tank, or you're putting it in your bulk tanks, whatever you're doing, you're not going to have that gel up issue. I haven't had any, and I've still. I mean, we've had cool days up here this year too.
What do you see on? What's your ratio, whatever that you're using?
How much additive? One ounce of this treats 30 gallons. So that 16-ounce bottle treats 480 gallons of fuel.
So what if they own, if you buy the extreme, how much does it treat? Same thing?
Same thing, yeah. I've still run on the same portions. and that's just because it's just whatever they're doing to it, they're making it a little bit more concentrated. That they, I mean, they spent a lot of time on that, redeveloping that.
Does it keep algae growing?
We've got generators, you know, these big generators for these commercial buildings, and they got their bulk tanks, and a lot of them are using biodiesel, and they're putting our product in there, and then every 6 months, like Gus was mentioning, they open the bottom of the tank and they fill up a 5 gallon gas can, and they shut that valve, and then they pour that same 5 gallons in the top just to agitate it. But they've done testing on it. We've had some that have gone for how many years? Five?
Yeah, we're at 4 years of zero, but they used it for 6 months before the first documented.
Yeah.
It's a skyscraper in Chicago. I work with Davis, the guy who we work with there. And they would have to, every 4 to 6 months, it was considered hazardous waste. They had to completely algicide it, and those tanks cost them about $11,000 to $12,000 a year. On average, that was their run. They bought one bottle. This is the only drawback I see to our product. It actually works. so they brought one bottle, they treated it, there's 450 gallons in that tank, and they have not had to run it. They haven't had any outages, but it has sat.
And they
haven't added any more XP3. They've had zero algae, they've had zero water. Because again, if you stretch that molecule out, then it can't, there's no water, algae can't grow. So you cannot grow without water. Well, our product will eliminate water completely because it stretches that molecule out so much, it's hydrogen and oxygen, that algae cannot grow. Plus, they put a dash of algaecide in it in case it were to come with algae in it, it will kill it. So, needless to say, that skyscraper bought one bottle, and we saved $12,000 a year, and they love us.
What about soy diesel? I really hate that stuff.
Yeah.
I don't even allow it in my tanks, honestly. Yeah. I mean...
You should.
I don't know. I mean, it's great. If you lived in Alabama, it would work fine. But you get any place that's going to get cold, that stuff gels up. I mean, you only have to have a percent. I mean, you don't have to have any of it in there before it causes havoc.
Yeah, in Indiana, you use a fair amount of that in your diesel.
Actually, by law, they can put 5% in and not tell you.
And not tell you. I know.
And that's all.
Like I said, she prepared me, so I didn't want to tell you. Here's the thing. What I would tell you is, if you think you're, I would run it a little bit extra. So if it, let's say you've got 30 gallons, I would, if I were you, because of its particular nature of what it does, I would run a little extra. So instead of 1 ounce head runner, it means 1.25 ounces. Run a little bit extra because that stuff is some nasty stuff. Here's the thing, your fuel is almost identical to ours. So it's really easy for me to talk about, Mike to talk about, you know, and with the diesel side, you've got some gas, but it's, you have very similar fuel. The most common number in Indiana is 13% alcohol. That's the most common number.
You're talking about in gas.
In gas. And so the most common number is 20% biodiesel in your standard diesel fuel. That's the most common number. So knowing that, whether it's soy, it doesn't matter, it's source, you know you have soy, you would just run a lecture and you're going to not have a problem.
Well, I changed fuel suppliers because of soy oil, soy diesel. We've gotten, the other company was sending me soy diesel, okay? We try to keep that out of our tanks. Best of my knowledge, we don't have it. We don't have any of it in our tanks, okay?
Yep.
Doesn't mean that somebody's not lying to us, you know? I mean, maybe my supplier.
Well, here's the thing. Suppliers are based on, I've got a brother-in-law that's a supplier, and they're going to go, if you've got a guy and they know you're going to watch for it, he's going to go to that line. But I guarantee you, because I've had this holiday tested, and they were 13.5% alcohol, nobody's testing them. Uh-huh. I had it tested because that particular sheet he's talking about, I was curious, so I bought the little kit, and I had a few places around where I lived tested. So the way I look at it, and I'll go back to when you look at these other products, why I got involved and why, you know, got these people involved is it actually works. The only thing I would do with, if I knew I had soy, I'd add a little extra. That's it. And then it doesn't matter if it's in there. Now you got peace of mind.
And extra is not going to hurt. It isn't, you know, yeah. That recommended dosage is just a minimum that they've figured out or factored out for it to be effective. You can add as much as you want.
You know? How much extra is the extreme cost?
I think it's about $10.
$10, yeah.
For the extreme.
$10 or what?
A bottle like this.
$10 more.
Now, if you went to, if you went to a gallon or a 2.5 gallon or something like that, you're going to do better. I mean, obviously, the more product you buy, the better cost per use price we can get you.
Yeah. Farm like yours at that many acres, you're not buying it by the small. You're buying it by the gallons. And they're, it's incidental difference.
For cars, because I'm actually should move in on that. I'm sorry, even though we're talking to you.
Yeah, go ahead. I can answer all
that's like the ratio for a standard year, 16-gallon tank. What you put in?
Well, 1 ounce on this treats 25 gallons. Okay. Now, if you started using this in your vehicle, I'd tell you to put an ounce in right off the bat for probably the first 5 tanks. You're okay. Not going to hurt by putting that little bit extra in there. We don't know how dirty your engine is, and we don't know how much water you're carrying in that fuel tank. So you might as well go ahead and put some extra in and then drop down to a maintenance level. At that point in time, I'd put 3/4 of an ounce in. You know, it's measured out here. It's half ounce, ounce, an ounce and a half. You know, so you could, you know, almost come up to the ounce line and put that in there, or just keep putting an ounce in it. You're not going to hurt anything. I personally like a little bit extra. I put extra in all of my stuff. I like that little bit more of a peace of mind. I would rather buy a new piece of equipment because I want it rather than I have to.
Mm-hmm. I'll share one thing. That sheet that Gus showed about ethanol. Yeah. Brian works with boats. Of course, we're in Minnesota. We got a lot more lakes than you have out in Indiana. But we have some pretty good ones. There's one I want to fish in particular. Anyway. You look at an E-Tech or Mercury or Yamaha, all three are the same. They have a fuel additive. And that same company showed in Yamaha, Mercury, and E-Tech, do not add these ingredients if you use E10 or more, period. Do not have these ingredients in it because they're alcohol. Then they show, the next thing down the line, they show Mercury, outboard fuel treatment. First 3 of 4 ingredients were what they said earlier not to use. Evinrude, first 2 and then the 4th. Ingredients not to use. Yamaha, same thing. And their fuel additive is alcohol based. And so you're adding to the problem. And then what happens is if you have these ingredients shown and you have a warranty issue, you are non-warranty. It says in bold print. on an Ebony, because mm-hmm. that was the only one I could find. They're bold print right now. If you have fuel, when you bring that engine in, they'll literally pull the fuel out of that carburetor to test it. And if you have anything above E10, you are non-warranty. But yet they sell a fuel additive that would bring you out of warranty.
Well, not only that, but like Gus had mentioned earlier, E15 is passed, but it's not mandated. That's why Holiday Gas Station up here has got 13% mm-hmm. in it. They can put it in and they won't get in trouble. And they're sneaking it in because they don't want these manufacturers freaking out, because they're the ones that are the lobbyists fighting the fuel right now, saying you're going to destroy our engines. And we can't just keep building new things for everything to deal with this stuff. A lot of us have got older equipment that we need to keep running. So we got to have a solution. Anything else? I love these questions.
Well, what's the right amount of ethanol that you put into to make gasoline burn fit? I mean, can you get by with 3% or 5%?
Zero.
Zero?
Well, ethanol, by its very nature, just like we all have nature, okay. God designed us, there's a nature to us. Ethanol's very nature is to suck water. That's what it does. It has a burn rate that is much different than gas. There is no good, and see, Brian was probably one of the easiest sales that way. I walked in, he knows the problems that's killing with small engines. It's what he does. He fixes snowmobiles, fixes boats, fixes chainsaws. Walk in and show him the demo how it eliminates water time. There is no good, safe amount of ethanol.
They put it in there for oxidized gasoline, so it burns the air.
Well, they put it in there because of farmer subsidization. It's not a burning.
The theory behind it too is also again emissions related. They wanted to reduce how much oil we're pulling out of the ground, and we give the farmers a kickback and all that kinds of stuff. You know, but here's the thing about the ethanol and why it's hard to have different amounts of it in there. While it is a good cleaning agent and does help with keeping some of the injectors and stuff clean on the equipment, like Gus was talking about with the phase out, they have to drop the octane of our fuel to accommodate the alcohol. So in phase out, when that separates, your octane rating drops on your fuel 2 to 3 points. Now that doesn't seem like a lot, but it's huge. You're not burning at full combustion. You're actually throwing more fuel out the tailpipe than before, because you're not getting a good complete.
You can only buy 91 octane gasoline, still doesn't have ethanol in it though. You can't really buy it anywhere. You can't be hooked on
it. There are certain stations, but there isn't many.
Yeah.
You can't hardly find good gasoline that doesn't have ethanol in it.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. And that's what they're doing. And I would be, I mean, we can get premium around here, non-ethanol premium around here. We can.
But
that's going to go by the wayside, I guarantee it. What they'll do is they'll mandate 15% ethanol in regular gas, mm-hmm. and then they'll put 5% in premium and tell you it's still a better option. That's what they're going to do.
Yeah.
I'll bet you money on that right now.
Yeah. You see, it was kind of fun today when I was coming here. I wish I could have more time. Big sign at the gas station, non-ethanol fuel. Big sign right there on the thing, because people are aware there's a problem. That's why there's money. I mean, that's why we're in this as a business, because there's a big problem.
So, yeah, again, 2 years of no problems in anything. I don't weed whip the lawn. I've got my bigger trucks and stuff like that, my big John Deere chipper and stuff like that, my big landscaper mm-hmm. trucks with the DT-466 and stuff in it. I'm not having any issues. And most of my stuff's all got a lot of miles on it. And we just got back from Florida here a couple of weeks ago, and we drove my wife's 2001 Suburban with the 6.0 motor in it that nobody liked. I got 14.5 miles of a gallon, and I didn't, that motor purred like a kitten all the way there and back.
It's got over 200,000 miles on it.
Yeah, it's 220,000 miles on it. And I would have never thought of that 3 years ago. Would have never took an engine that far, would have never trusted it. Not a problem now. Yeah, I might lose a serpentine belt or an idler pulley or something like that, but you know, standard other mechanical issues that can be roadside fixed, but I wouldn't have to worry about a motor seizing up.
I got a question the other day. Is there anything that would affect the warranty on any new diesel, new gas?
This stuff? Absolutely not. No. Nope.
I thought so.
No, it's an organic synthetic product. It won't hurt anything. I know that's a big issue coming from the boat world, because the boat world is, they're goofy about that. You know, and, you know, they like to promote their products, and they like to only see their products in there, but they don't solve the problem. And then you can look at that fueltesters.com, and you can see what exactly what Brian's talking about. Even their own products are containing ethanol and stuff in them. Naphtha or isopropyl alcohol even, too. Those are the three things that are in them. And, yeah, it's a big issue. And again, talking about water-related issues with the boats, I mean, a lot of these new boats now, they come with dual-fuel water separators on them, just like a diesel truck. So it's a big problem, you know. In the marine industry, my advice is, if you're selling that and you're talking to people with that, I triple dose it. Why not? You know, you got a 25-gallon tank, put 3 ounces in that thing. I just bought a Grady White last year, 22-foot with, you know, outriggers and downriggers and everything on it for fishing Michigan and fishing Lake of the Woods. And the guy that had it, he had 2-year-old gas in it. And there's no way to get that gas out of there without tearing the boat apart and, you know, getting into the top of the tanks. So I put 3 bottles in my 40-gallon tank, and then I topped it off. And then what I did after that is, it did such a good job of flushing the system, I replaced my 2 fuel filters in it after that, because it flushed a lot of rust and garbage right into them. So I replaced them, and now that thing runs great. I can idle that big boat, I can idle it at 1 mile an hour. Oh, anything else?
Cost me $200 last summer to get the filters changed and filtered out. But I used some XP3, but it didn't use enough. And it just clogged. It burned it out. I think my son took it out and didn't put any XP3 in it. Because it ran perfectly. And I don't think he put any XP3 in it. And they got stranded out there about a mile and a half out from the landing.
It's kind of funny. I got a pretty good deal on a power ice auger. You know, a guy wanted to sell it to me, and he brought it up, and it wouldn't start. He's sitting there pulling on, it wouldn't start. I'm like, that's all right, I'll take it anyway. Then he added XP3 to it, got it started, and it started out with just white smoke coming out of that exhaust, right? And then all of a sudden, just clear. So, and that thing works fine, you know. And it's got XP3 sitting in it. I didn't even use it this winter. I guarantee I can go probably rip on it. I'd probably get it 3 pulls. So, it's a good product. You know, we really got 3 different options here for anybody. Is one, if you want to just buy a bottle and be a customer, that's awesome. We can do that. We can accommodate. We also have a system where we can set you up as a reseller. If you want to sell the product, you got a storefront or something like that, you want to put one of these display boxes out, sell the product, we've got that option. And we've also got the distributor option. We can set people up to become a distributor and promote that way and make the money on that. So get together with whoever you brought you and talk to them about it, see what you want to do. But I wouldn't leave here without a bottle if I was you.
No pressure.